against your relative, do not be swerved by anything. Be just witness, even if it's against you and against yourself. I think in one of the universities in America, whether it's Harvard or somewhere, they have this plaque, this statement of the Quran, to show in a legal school. But this is a sublime teaching that everyone should uphold. Where? If you are going to give witness, be a just witness, even if it goes against your interest or the interest of your family and your own. This is what the Quran says. Be a just witness. The Quran says always speak the truth. Never speak the lies. Stand firm in the truth. Be kind and be merciful. Do not mock people. Do not mock a nation or a community. It may be that they're better than you. Do not insult. Do not backbite. So all of this teaching, your heart will resonate. You say, yeah, of course. I like that teaching. Of course I do. It says what? Be compassionate to people. Be merciful to people. Be kind to people. Be just. Of course it's what your heart wants. It says, be you sincere. Of course. It says, read and reflect and investigate. That's what you are doing. That's what your mind wants. So when you read the Quran, you will see you already believe in it. Because what the Quran says about this teaching, you already have taken in already. So what the Quran is basically saying, why would you not come to Islam? What's stopping you? Why would you still persist in following your own desires instead of following the path of the prophets and messengers? Because through the prophets and messengers, the Creator has given us the best guidance of life, which will then determine the effects in the hereafter. For example, when you interact with people, what do you do? Do you deceive them? Or do you always deal with them honestly? The people who have money and wealth and power and means, they will say, if you can overcome them by your deception, so what? You become more richer and richer. He's mentality of the people. Quran says no. In fact, the Quran talks about usury in the sense of God and his messengers dictate war on interest and usury. When? No, in this world today. If you want to borrow money, £1,000, £10,000, do you pay the same amount back?
Okay, let me explain.
You have to pay huge amount of interest. Why? Because they're exploiting your weakness. They know you are in need, and these greedy individuals, they want to capitalize and make more money on your weakness. Islam says no. You cannot deal with this kind of things. When you interact financially, if someone wants to borrow money, give the same amount. Don't put interest on charge. No. So this is more just rather than being so greedy and so on. So when the Quran talks about these things, human interactions, it tells you to deal with those people fairly. Be just.
You did it. No.
So when you examine Islam, when you examine the Quran, your heart will not disagree with the teacher. So when you find that the Quran says, fight those who fight you. Fight those who fight you.
Christian unbelievers.
The Quran says, that's the Quran. That's the
Quran. He's not in jizya. What does he mean? Taxes. You have to pay taxes. If you don't pay the taxes, you get killed.
Why? Because there are moments in time
have
where
you tell you about this, you know, did you read the hadith?
We have family. If your family is attacked, are you going to say, oh, here's my child underneath the bed, kill him as well? You're not going to do that. You are going to, with all your strength and ability, defend yourself. You'll say, no, you're not going to get away, you're not going to harm my dad, my mom, my sister, my brother, my youngster. I will try to stop you from doing that. This is human nature, how we want to protect our own self, our own family. So if you are part of a brotherhood or a sisterhood, your own people, you want to protect them. So if excuse me. If you see your life, the life of your own people, your community is in danger and threatened, you will resist and you will defend yourself, you will fight. But who do you fight? Are you going to fight when they have done all these things and go at night time and find the little kids and then kill them like a coward? You fight the aggressors, you fight those who fight you. This is the teaching of Islam. You don't fight non-combatants. You don't kill women, children, old men, monks, priests. This is the clear teaching of Islam. So what happened yesterday? What happened a few days ago, weeks ago in Manchester? Or in Westminster Bridge and so on? Lunatics. Actions of lunatics.
Muslim lunatics.
Of course. That's what they claim to be, right?
But do you say Allahu Akbar?
But clearly, they are lunatics. Because it
that's
is
Islamic like, term.
Listen, that's Islamic a lunatic.
It's not a person heard who's really. A Hindu man say Allahu Akbar. I never heard Christians say Allahu Akbar.
Let me ask you a question.
A more Muslim.
Let me ask you a question, if I may, right? If a Muslim says, I'm a Muslim, my name is Abdullah, and goes and rapes a woman, and says, Allahu Akbar, and rapes a woman. And do you think now the whole Muslim world should say, I apologize on his behalf, this guy is clearly crazy. Islam says no to rape, you can't rape anyone.
No, it doesn't say that. It says you can take sex slaves and you can rape the sex slaves. It says that very clearly.
You know what?
You come and go.
Right? You come and go.
Yeah, because you just never stop talking.
No, you find, for some reason, he thinks somehow you're having some sense and it will have an effect on you. He doesn't appreciate that. Unfortunately, this is the reality. If I see someone suddenly realizes that, okay, racism is bad, even if it came from an atheist who advised, I say, thank you for making you understand that racism is bad. I'm not going to say, I have to like totally dismantle that. No, actually, racism is good, because how can you believe in what the atheist says? No. Good can come from lots of people, but what we're saying is, ultimately, what is good is described by God. Okay? Even though what you do, actions, which may be actions of goodness, but if you deserve, if you hope for a reward in the hereafter, you as an atheist will be getting it, because
so
you did not acknowledge the one who created you. So if you work for a company, just to illustrate my point, if you work for a company, and then there's a competitor, right, of this company. And then you do all the works with the other guys, other companies. You distribute their leaflets, do their marketing and so on and so forth. Do you expect at the end of the day, because you're employed, your employer should really give you good wages because you do their work? If you are employed for a company, do the works of that company. So if you do not want to believe God is your creator, don't expect God's going to reward you in the hereafter, even though you do things good. You've been kind and compassionate, so on. What you've done, totally said, you don't exist. You're not my creator. So don't expect God to reward you in the hereafter, because he won't. He will require you to have this acknowledgement that you are his creation, and he also requires you to also have actions done, which is what is being asked of you to do.
Does he require the same thing from animals?
From what?
Animals.
No, animal follow instincts.
Oh, right. So we're different.
We are different from animals, and clearly you can see that.
So why did God ever create us so recently? Because the universe is 14 billion years old. The Earth is 3.5 billion years old. We've only been here, at best, the last million years. So if the life of the universe is a full year, we've been here 5 seconds before midnight. So if we're the unique animal that he wants to test, and we're the of what the Earth is of creation, why did he only create us so recently?
God says in the Quran, "Kulla yawmin huwa fi sha'an." This is an Arabic Quran, right? Every day, God is with new affairs. So we don't believe that God only creates and that's it. Continuously there's there. We are part of this creation that God has told us. Yes, of course. God is not someone like a Judeo-Christian God. He created 6 days and on the seventh day he rested because he needed refreshment. Don't use words which is not there. The Jewish and the Christian Bible says God created in heaven there 6 days, and the seventh day he rested, and then he got refreshed. So I'm not sure whether because of tiredness or whatever reason. In Islam, no. God doesn't need refreshing, because he creates and he doesn't get any kind of...
Why does he need us to worship him? What's that about?
Can I answer one question? I'm sure as an atheist you have billions
of questions. You're impossible to answer one question. You're going to take an hour to answer one question.
You said, why is it that in the fraction of a second, like you yesterday, God is creating us with the free will to worship him and so on. I'm saying, God is creating his own races with you first. We are part of his creation. What is required of us is what we need to understand for our own life. There might be other life elsewhere.
Allow me to
finish. There might be other life elsewhere.
Allow me to finish. This guy never finishes.
If you don't like my answer, then it's up to you.
You never have answers. Just talk and talk.
What I'm saying, if God created us, it's important for us to know about our creation. We know that God is eternal with no beginning. Our universe, according to you just said, 14 billion years ago. Compared to eternity, this is very recent, right? Eternity has gone already past. Are you saying God only created 50 billion years ago and that's it? Time is very relative. Time is very relative. So you must understand that, okay? When you talk about now or later, if I said God created human beings, suppose now God created human beings, the moment he created the universe, you would say, why not later? You can ask all these zillions of questions, you can never be satisfied saying, for example, a clear example, Muslims pray 5 times a day. You will say, why 5? Why not 3? Why not 4? Why not 6? See, I say, okay, 4 times a day. Okay, why not 7? This is the kind of question you
need to ask.
I have seen people saying. So what I'm saying is, as rational, reasonable person, inshallah, when you examine the Quran, you will see, as I'm repeating again, the word resonate. The Quranic teaching will resonate with your heart and your mind. There are certain things which you might find not palatable, and this is for this reason. Because you could be a vegetarian, the Quran says you can eat, you know,
absolutely, and therefore,
appropriately slaughtered animals, like a cow or a sheep and so on. As a vegetarian, you might say, how can you take life? But that's your own outlook of life. Vegetarianism is not what God says to us. For example, I have to make a point because some people become very emotional in their outlook of God. You know, we have seen we have in our stomach enzymes to digest some animal protein. So in our makeup, we are not made vegetarian. Sorry? In our makeup, we are not made vegetarian. We are made to digest meat, consume meat. So if someone, because of the vegetarianism, if someone, because of the vegetarianism, say, how can I accept the teaching of the Quran because it says you can eat meat? You are creating a false obstacle. Why? Because you are taking your own understanding of life, saying, and saying, this should be
the poor.
This should be universally applied. So, yes, you find, like, the teaching of war. Some people might be very pacifist and not like it, but that doesn't stop from understanding that fighting sometimes is a necessity. If England is invaded by France now, do you think the English people in the army would say they have to exchange powers? Of course not. Tell me the answer that our fighting can be justified in some occasions. When the police often employs violence to stop a criminal, are you going to say, why are you violent? Because the police might shoot someone on the street from stabbing another person. This guy got a knife. That was violence, shooting someone on the street.
Should have come
but that violence was justified. Because that was a clearly criminal intent. So police used justifiable violence to stop it. Islam is a highly punishment system in which there are certain punishments which might be
Jewish
punishments. And there's a reason for punishment. Why? Because God wants a stable society in which people are living. safety. So if people were to now take guns, you know, and then start killing people, they need to be dealt with. In any society, Islam has a system where these people will be punished. For example, if a highway robber comes and then in broad daylight, they get the highest punishment. Why? Because that's not like the robber who goes in the night, darkness of the night, and then starts stealing without you knowing it. Because he's trying to steal without you knowing it. Very important question. This guy, this individual, is different from an individual who comes along in broad daylight and says, I'm going to kill you. Broad daylight. So the punishment system cannot be the same for both of them. If a person steals 20 pounds and a person kills 20 people, do you think the punishment will be the same one day in prison? Because the crimes are of a different magnitude. So Islam has certain punishments which has the highest probability of punishment. They are called capital offenses.
The Jesus made about himself being
why? Because they destabilize the functioning public society.
For example, if you
first, our discussion you the judge can give you a warning that you go in for fine jewels for your physical and for other punishment, very simple. With the severity punishment, like for example,
any
murdering, punishment for a murder. But here comes Jesus, 10 pounds. And he says, do you think murder will increase or decrease?
Someone's
going to say, no, no, I can get away with 2 pounds. But if the punishment of the murder is, you will force us to give your own life, you will be executed.
Yes, but if you said, I am who I am,
So, when you are going to make your own decision, make your decision with your knowledge and understanding, rather than
What did Jesus say?
Don't be sorry.
Me as a judge, so that all honor the Son.
Do not be offended.